Kit. We are really, really happy to have him here. I'll have some introductory remarks. We'll have a compilation, actually, of some clips from some of his films. Then we'll begin a question and answer session, just to let you know what's happening for this evening. I'd first like to take a moment to express some thanks for this evening's sponsors, American University's Center for Latin American and Latino Studies, and its interim director, Jayesh Rathrod, and the Mexican Ministry of Culture's National Council for Culture and the Arts, FONCA, represented here in D.C. by our colleagues from the Mexican Cultural Institute. Among them, I would like to give a special thanks to Executive Director Alberto Fierro, thank you very much, and Deputy Director Gustavo Morales, as always, where's Gustavo? Gustavo's in the back. Hi, thanks. as a result of this productive partnership between American University and Conaculta, we're delighted to welcome Maestro Aimke in this ongoing series of leading Mexican artists to visit and engage with American University faculty and students and with the broader Washington, D.C. community. I'd also very much like to thank Alexandra Vranas and Ines Luego de Crom. You guys are here and there. Thank you so much for doing all the legwork in putting all of this together. And finally, I'd like to thank my co-panelists on this particular panel. I am Jeff Middens from the Department of Literature, Nuria Villanova from the Department of World Languages and Cultures, and Dolores Tierney, who is a fellow with CLALS this year and is a long time. We just realized that we've known each other for 20 years, which is scary, and is visiting 20, here. 21. Jeez. And she's visiting from University of Sussex, so thank you guys all for coming here. I would like to begin my introduction of tonight's speaker with a bit of a personal anecdote. The Latin American Film Festival that is currently being sponsored by the Inter-American Development Bank and the American Film Institute used to be organized by the Organization of American States. And back in 2005, I was asked to be a judge for that first year when they decided to give prizes to in particular categories. That was a good year with a number of very good movies which you might be familiar with if you know something about Latin American film. That was the year of Whiskey that came from Uruguay, Paper Dove, Paloma de Papel from Peru, Buenos Aires, 100 Kilometers from Argentina. But late into my viewing experience, I watched what appeared to be a very droll movie about two boys playing video games in their apartment. And when the electricity goes off the rest of that afternoon, when they encounter a pot brownie baking neighbor and a pizza delivery guy who won't leave until he gets paid, despite having arrived 31 minutes past the time that the pizza was ordered, set up a very careful, stunning study of contemporary life in Mexico City at the crossroads. That year, Temporada de Patos, duck season, was the clear and unanimous winner of, you may not even know that, of the DC Latin American Film Festival and began my own fascination with Fernando Aimke. This isn't in my notes here, but I just asked Nuria, how long have we been doing this? And our particular partnership with Conaculta goes back now 5 years. I will confess that when they asked who we wanted to bring, 5 years ago, you were the name that I put on the list, so I have been waiting 5 years for this. And I'm thrilled that this is finally happening. Born in 1970 and educated at the UNAM, Fernando Aimke has started, as many of his contemporaries did, with work in short films and video clips before bringing his eye to feature films with Duck Season in 2004. After premiering at the Cannes Film Festival, Duck Season went on to win numerous awards all over the world. Then debuting at the Berlin Film Festival in 2008, his second feature, Lake Tahoe, shows on the surface a young man simply trying to find a car part for his broken-down car. But his attempts to find it slowly reveal layers of the sadness that imbue his everyday life. His third film, Club Sandwich, centers around another teenage boy at the cusp of adulthood, this time at a resort hotel with his young mother, who slowly realizes that her own position in her son's life is about to change. And Club Sandwich, which if anybody has, if you've, in the library we have copies of both Duck Season and Lake Tahoe, but you probably haven't been able to find Club Sandwich. We will be showing that tomorrow at the Inter-American Development Bank. The screening is at 6 p.m. And so do come out for that, because that is actually not available for in the United States. So you really want to check that out. Imgur's work takes meticulously framed scenes that season what appear to be casual happenings of the quotidian, allowing humor and pathos of the latter to transcend into something profound and beautiful. I've never seen another director who frames their work with such careful precision, or who imbues the silences with such matter-of-fact meaning. Maria Brené Prudencio, the Bolivian-born star of Club Sandwich, and, this is the other surprise, actually a friend of mine from high school, when we went to high school in Lima, Peru.
Maria René.
Maria René. So I sent her a Facebook message 3 days ago and said, tell me something. What's it like? And she actually described your filmmaking as almost mathematical, but mathematical in an aesthetic sense. He can spend 45 minutes arranging a blanket so that the fabric will curve in a way that is harmonic with the framing of the shot, or he will ask you to count to 23 between one line of dialogue and the next to ensure that the phrasing is timed exactly right. His passion for the minute is relentless, which is why his characters are also so touching. This very much, if you're familiar with his work, sometimes it appears that it's all about, and other people have written a lot about setting, but they are really, really character studies, and the way in which those characters come out in such a layered way is absolutely magical. I had something in here. We were originally going to show all of a short film called La Bienvenida, but we've had problems with the DVD. But that's okay, because we actually have a compilation of some of his work, including scenes from Duck Season, from Lake Tahoe, and the last part of La Bienvenida as well. So we'll take a look at those now so that you can see some of Imke's work, and we'll come back and chat with him in just a minute.
Amateur profesional o mundialista. ¿Mundialista?
Pues qué, ¿hay otro?
Oye, ¿puedes poner 15 minutos en tu cronómetro?
Estamos
arrancando la
prueba. Muy interesante entre dos equipos muy igualados. El balón llega a la zona de peligro. Adelante el balón hacia una buena posición.
Estaba distraído.
Han sabido mover muy bien el balón hasta encontrar el hueco y marcarlo. Bueno, llevamos un minuto de partido y hemos asistido al primer tanto del encuentro. Se anticipa el control cortando el ataque. Perfectamente el esférico. El pase ha sido bueno.
¡Gol!
Está intentando desmarcarse. Ha estado muy rápido al buscar el espacio con esa carrera. Llega el esférico a un compañero.
Se la pared,
se
la pantalla, va a tirar.
¡Gol! Eso tiene que ser gol.
¡Gol!
Este corner lleva peligro.
¡Gol!
¡Qué partido tan igualado en su primera parte!
Todo parece indicar que habrá pizzas gratis.
Seguro que esta segunda parte nos depara mucha emoción y buen juego.
Cuidado.
Llega a la zona de peligro. A punto ha estado de ser gol. Cuidado en la línea media sin posibilidad de contraataque. ¡Ahí está!
¡Gol! ¡Gol!
a checar.
Gracias.
échale a cargo, mamá.
Sí, mijo, no te preocupes, ahí. Te regresas temprano, ¿eh?
I'm sad we didn't get to the end of that one. There's a riveting conclusion to that that I love. Please give a warm welcome to Fernando Aimke. I guess I'll begin the questioning and taking a little bit with what Maria René was saying about, because your style is very distinctive, speaks so well to your characters. How did you come to this style, this particular way of thinking? Such a simple
question.
It's
important to say that at this moment I'm working again with Maria René. She's a very good writer, so we are working on a TV series. So yes, we are working, and we are having a very hard time.
She did not tell me this. Oh, good. No,
very hard time because it's very difficult in some ways. The style, I don't know. It's not something that I see like a style. It's just the way that I found to approach to the characters, to take the time they need to develop. We don't shoot too much scenes per day. We shoot like one or two scenes per day, but we try to change dialogues. We try to improvise. We try to see if the scene could work or not. And sometimes I find that it's just some small detail that changes all the sense of the scene. So it's a very meticulous work. Maria René, she told me that I was like the Mississippi director, because everything was like, okay, count four Mississippi, one Mississippi, two Mississippi, two Mississippi. And it was, sometimes it was really funny because one of the actresses, the young one, mm-hmm. I asked her, please count to 10. And she was doing the scene and counting to 10. And I was like, please count to 10. And she was like, I'm counting to 10. And I was like, no, you don't, not counting to 10. Because he's counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And I was like, no, 1, 2, 3. So it's, I'm very obsessed with the rhythm of the scene. The moment when they speak, the silence, it's not the silence because the silence, it's because something are not said. The characters are afraid to say something, so we use the silence in that cases.
So the counting thing was real.
Yeah.
The counting issue was real.
Yeah.
As a side note, I left it out. She actually did say 23 Mississippis, but I thought that was her thing. So I left that out of the introduction.
Yeah.
So tell us, Fernando, what is the highest you have made anybody count? Okay.
I don't know, it's really interesting because I work with actors and non-actors. I don't care. I don't have to go with. I don't have some kind of dogma. But sometimes with the actors, it's really interesting because it's like they go into desarmarse.
They shed themselves.
Uh-huh. So they are prepared for the scene, and it's like, no, don't worry about the scene. Don't worry about this. Just count to 10. It's like, okay, so just count. Yes, just count.
And my students now. Can I follow up on your question? I would like to know, it seems that you feel very comfortable both in black and white and in color.
Uh-huh.
And it seems that this is probably not just an arbitrary decision. There mm-hmm. might be something behind. Can you tell us about that?
Well, I found in black and white more rhythm in terms of the framing. It's more about geometric forms. Mm-hmm. So I found some rhythm, some sense of the scene with the black and white. It's really strange because when we put some scene, we rehearse a lot, but we put out the camera, so the actors are not aware of the camera, so they can improvise and change. But also we in the framing, we should change the size of the frame. And I'm really obsessed with the rhythm of the frame. Really, really obsessed with that. the time, I think that dialogues, it's like equilibrium between the dialogues, the size, the geometric forms, everything creates a very, for me, balanced sense.
But sometimes you choose color.
Yes.
So
but
you're looking for something different.
Yes. In our second film, Lake Tahoe, we work with color, but also it was really, really, really well designed with the photographer. The director of photography, Alexis Abbe, I think is one of the most greatest photographers. And he did a very good job, and everything was really planned, all the colors. So we have like photographs and of the colors. So there's a evolution of the colors in terms of the character developing. So yes, and also with color. But every time with a film, there's a certain moment that I said, okay, let's do it in black and white. because I think that color is really, really difficult to work with. And so yes, all the time it's like, okay. And the producers are like, no, please don't black and white, no. Yes, in Duck Season, Temporada de Patos, we had patrocinador, sponsor. It was Windows, because the game. So they will put money, and when I said this will be black and white, they say so. We won't put money.
Dolores.
Oh, I kind of already asked my questions when I met Fernando a few minutes ago, because I was really excited to meet him. But I have some other questions. So, Fernando, so Temporada de Patos, Duck Season, won the Independent Spirit Award. And you know that, of course you know that. I'm saying it to you like you didn't know. And Lake Tahoe was sponsored and developed at the Sundance mm-hmm. Institute in their screenwriters lab. And I wondered how you see, or whether you see, an institutional and kind of aesthetic relationship between North American independent cinema and Mexican independent cinema, because certain people have talked about your films as neither art cinema nor commercial, but independent Mexican cinema. So, oye, am I saying it? Am I speaking into the microphone? No. Did you hear that? Yeah?
About the relation between independent cinema
yeah.
in the United States and independent
yeah.
cinema in Mexico.
Whether you see between your work and other people's work or at all.
Mm-hmm. There's not so much co-productions between independent cinema in the United States and Mexico. There's this program from Sundance Institute, but not too much co-productions with the United States and independent cinema. That would be great, but it's not.
What about a kind of a textual, aesthetic kind of relationship? You know, a lot of people talked about Temporada de Patos, Duck Season, in relation to films like Jim Jarmusch's. Stranger than Paradise. Sorry. And other films like that, a similar kind of static camera. Are you happy about that? Okay. You happy about that?
Yeah.
Right, so yeah, I wondered if that's something that's influenced you in particular.
Of course.
That's kind of
the films of Jim Jarmusch, I think that it influenced a lot of filmmakers around the world. The way he did those films. A lot of films, like Whiskey, you were talking about Whiskey, and 25 Watts from the same filmmakers. So it's this kind of, it's not like a comedy, it's like a melancholic comedy. And I think that it influences a lot, the cinema all around the world. So yes, but there's, you can go to see the influences of Jim Jarmusch, and you can see the influences from Japanese directors like Yasuhiro Ozu, or the neorealist Italian cinema. So it's like a constant dialogue between. Yes. For example, I have a lot of influence from the neorealist cinema, because they worked with non-actors, so in a lot of my films I work with non-actors, but also from Ozu. Does anybody have seen the films of Ozu?
Yeah.
Who else? No.
Me. Hello. Yes. Okay.
Just you. Okay. He's a great filmmaker. You should see it. No, and he is really amazing, because he did, I don't know, like hundreds of films, and all of the films are just like very, very similar. It's stories about families, very simple, very human. Really, it was like a just one framing.
With very careful framing, yes.
Very careful framing, yes, yes, yes. But it's really, really amazing. So there's this influence. Jarmusch was a fan of Ozu. So it's like a dialogue between cinemas all around the world.
I don't know whether this steps on a question you might have, Dolores, but I'll ask it anyway. In terms of influences and coordination, I'm curious to know about your own, how you feel your relationship to Mexican filmmaking. Most people, and because a good portion of this room are part of my classes, probably know of Mexican filmmaking, of the three that have, you know, been broken very big, Cuarón del Toro and González Iñárritu. And Cuarón produced Duck Season as well, right? Or was
distributed.
What is your own relationship with Mexican cinema now? Do you, like, you're clearly part of the current group. You're in Revolución, and that's not the only omnibus film also that you're involved in. So what? How do you feel your own relationship in terms with Mexican cinema?
We were talking about that.
I knew that she was going to ask that.
I asked it earlier. different, but also different.
Yeah, we had, actually, that's true. The three of us are curious about this.
It's amazing what's happening with Mexican cinema, because we had a lot of films in all the film festivals all around the world, and then the three Mexican filmmakers did it great in the United States, but those weren't Mexican films. right now, at this moment, Mexican cinema is changing a lot, because we have a very good fund called 189. It's financial support from the government. And it's really good, but at the same time, we are producing more commercial films, more commercial films, and a lot of films that are more risky. It's not being so well supported, and when you try to find funds in co-production with Europe, with Germany or France, you ask for support for some kind of films, and they will say no, because you have this fund, the 8189, so it's difficult to find co-productions. So you have to find those fundings in Mexico, but they are looking at different kind of films, more commercial. And I don't have an issue with commercial films, but I think it's very important for a cinematography to have diversity, to have like a commercial films, more risky films. So right now in Mexico, it's really good. We are producing a lot of films per year, 100 something, but I think that there's not so much risky films. There are something really important happening in documentary. Something really, really important. Documentary and
Ambulante.
Ambulante, yes. But they are amazing films, because it's really interesting, because the film industry, I think all around the world, is very, how do you say, machista?
Chauvinist.
In the film industry, it's like the director and the assistants and all the crew are with men. And I think that women find in documentary a different structure, because they are with their camera, a small crew, a total different structure. And they're creating amazing work, like Tatiana Hueso.
Bellas de Noche.
Yeah. We produce a documentary of María José Cuevas called Bellas de Noche, an amazing film. So it's very beautiful, because it's a new kind of vision, more patient, more human. And that's great. And it's amazing, because all of the films of the Tres Amigos, they are very, very powerful films. It's very, like, I call them very muscular films. Mm-hmm. It's very, like, and it's in documentary, it's totally different. Like, filmmakers like Tatiana Hueso and María José Cuevas, it's a new way of seeing reality. It's a documentary that is supposed to be very tough, but it's at the same time very, very sweet and tender. And I think that's what I'm most interested right now in Mexican cinema, the documentary. It's really, really interesting.
I have two questions, actually. One, I think the one that was the last one, but I think I'll put it now, because it follows up on what you said, is about Mexican cinema and very diverse and rich tradition since the 30s, and of course this kind of boom in since 2000, probably after Morris Perros. And I would like to know what you think that is still missing there. So what is it that we have not yet seen in Mexican cinema? And in that sense, what are your plans for the future to contribute to what we have not yet seen? So that was the last question, but you know, I think it kind of links with what he said, so I'll ask you now.
I think in my opinion, the most important or terrible problem in Mexican cinema is distribution and exhibition. We have like 100 films produced per year, but there were not spaces to see those films. And it's really important if you want to create a movement. Called Mexican cinema is not just about producing films, you have to produce audiences. That's the most terrible problem in Mexico. In Mexico, there was just one exhibition company, so that creates, it's a monopoly. So it's impossible to see different kind of films. I would like to have in Mexican cinema diversity. I think it's the most important thing for a cinema. And at this moment, we don't have that diversity in the exhibition. It's very, very sad, because those films, those great films like a Bellas de Noche documentary, will have a small distribution, and it will go. It will compete with, I don't know, with Wonder Woman. That it's okay, Wonder Woman is okay, but we need to have that diversity. We need that diversity, because if we don't have that diversity, it will be very, there's no cinema.
Well, a quick follow-up, is that why you are heading into television now? That seems to be a trend in the United States, that filmmakers who are unsatisfied are going to, you know, to Netflix, to, and that's why you're heading that way also.
Yes, yes, mm-hmm. But at the same time, it's...
because Mexican television is also fraught with
Mexican,
the same issues. Right?
Mexican television is terrible. It's terrible. But not Netflix. No, Mexican television, we were governed by Televisa. Like for, I don't know, a
Ever.
Lot of, for, forever. I remember, and I grew up with Televisa. And it was terrible. So people are done with that. Mm-hmm. So right now there are things coming with Netflix, but I don't know. I have an issue with the series. Mm-hmm. I love the series, but it's like, how do you say, botana?
Like a snack.
A snack? Mm-hmm. That you can see a lot of episodes. And it's like a snack, and it's good. But you never have this sensation of a
being
real meal, like with the supper, with the salad, with the coffee at the end. And a feature film is that.
Yes.
You go to see a film, and it's like the complete experience.
Yes.
And with the TV series, it's like a snack. I was obsessed with Narcos. I think it's a very, very good series. Mm-hmm. But at the end, it was like, no, come on. No, it's not eating, and the snacks are really good. It's like a cool.
That's why they call it binge viewing, isn't it? Because it's like binge feeding. But then Jose Padilla, a Brazilian director, very much kind of began that series, although he didn't direct all the episodes.
Yeah, yeah,
he
Narcos.
Yeah, and lots of in Argentina, lots of directors, Trapero and others are working in television right now too, because they're also deciding that they prefer that medium on another level.
Yes.
Not necessarily working with Netflix.
Mm-hmm.
I'm particularly addicted to all Netflix right now.
The director of this film that in Mexico was huge. I think that maybe here, too, called Nosotros Nobles.
The Noble Family, I think they called it.
Noble Family.
Mm-hmm.
It was a huge success in Mexico, and now he's doing a TV series for Netflix, Club de Cuervos.
Mm-hmm. Dolores, do you have another?
Well, my other question was a lot about Eficine, which is the one... which I, again, we kind of touched on some of them. I suppose I kind of wanted to ask a little bit more about things like humour and composition, to be really like precise and filmic. So one of the things I loved about Club Sandwich was not just the title, which kind of works on so many levels, you know, like the mum and the son and the daughter are all a sandwich and he's in between, but that's what they, it's also a place they've been to, and the sandwich is also the idea of a relationship where there's too many people, but also feeling apretado, like squashed. I loved it because because you have to do that to a club sandwich too, because there's so much in it, isn't there? You have to kind of. I loved that title, but one of the things, that, and you talked a lot about the precision in how you organise scenes. I loved the fact that Club Sandwich has lots of two shots, the mum and the son, and then it has two shots of Yasmin and Hector, and then it's Yasmin, Hector and Paloma, the mother, Rene, and how the humour is often about the fact that this is the same composition, but it's different people. It's the daughter, it's the girl, sorry, and the son, and then it's the mother too. And she always entrometerse, she always gets in there. And I just wondered, you know, how much that idea of two to different two to three was all kind of you playing with the idea of relationships and the kind of poetry and dynamics in between a two shot and a three shot. Mm-hmm. So that's really precise. But I kind of wanted to ask that question. Is that okay?
Again, yes, come see the movie tomorrow. Cause it's
you have to see it.
Yeah. Yes, you have to see it. Because but I really, really enjoyed the two shots to put the characters in this frame and being themselves.
And counting.
Yes, of course. And yes, I thought about the most natural way to present this relationship between a mother and a son. And it's very natural because you can see the son with his, how do you say, calzones? Underwear. And it's the mother and the son, and the son with his underwear. So it's a kind of.
It's a bit uncomfortable.
Yes, very uncomfortable. But it's like a relationship. So it's very.
There's an intimacy in those two
shots.
There's
an intimacy, yes. And it's. Yeah. Something it's changing, and you see this boy, this 13 years old boy with his underwear, and you said that's not so good at this moment, but they don't realize that they are like in some way like trapped in a relationship that is not working anymore.
When she gets him to sing that song about being a little boy, and everything I do is for you, the muerte in Hawaii, really touching, making me cry a bit, because it's about parents and and children, and she wants him to be the one.
And all the environment around them, the mother and the child, we work a lot on that there's no nature chaos. It's very controlled. All the relationship between the mother and the son, most of the time, is on the room. There's no like a nature around of them. The art director of Club Sandwich was Eugenio Caballero, who was the art director of films like El Laberinto del Fauno.
Wow.
So, Pat's Labyrinth. So it's really interesting to see how he worked on those huge films and how he worked in this film. Everything is like all the colors are really very well designed, and everything was really. I don't know if it was too much. some people said that maybe we pulled the
las riendas,
the reins, yeah,
a little bit too much.
We have other questions, but we are also know that you might have questions out there. So we'll start. We'll start with you. Yes.
All right. So my name's Jay. I have two questions. A real short one for my husband, and then my question. My husband. I watched Lake Tahoe last night with him. Both really enjoyed it. He wanted to know if the dog Sika is an allusion to Vittorio De Sica. And then my question is about, and I also watched Duck Season today, and the stillness of the camera, and there obviously there's the moments in Duck Season, or the video game, or the sort of the memory sequences where the camera moves, but it's often very still, same in Lake Tahoe, and I was wondering, is that to achieve an objective distance on the subject that you're filming, or is it because, as been alluding or mentioned in this conversation, this sort of obsessive attention to composition, which that sort of allows you greater control?
It was really organic, the way we shoot Duck Season. It was our first film, we didn't know what we were doing. Really, it was like a total mess, but a control mess. Because we were only in one location, so we designed the film completely before the shooting. I lived there with the DP, I think that maybe 2 or 3 weeks. So there are the photographer, the first ID, and I. And we designed all the film, and all, everything, like hue and count. And then I found, and it was not conscious, that we were like a kind of, how do you say, el que observa, el que espía, voyeurist.
Yeah.
Like a voyeurist kind of camera. So there's a certain distance. You never go into a very close frame. It's like always like seeing, like being one of the paints on the wall, just seeing these kids. And it was really organic. We didn't have this plan, like, oh, we will be like this voyeuristic kind of view. It was really, really organic. And we were, the most important thing is that we were fascinated by our characters. We were in love with the characters. So we put the camera, we said to them, okay, try to do what you have to do. Give life to this scene. And they do it, and we were like, oh, fascinated. We changed some things. Dog Season were much, there were much freedom than in the other films. In the Dog Season, I learned a lot from the teenagers, from these guys.
Thanks. Hi, thank you so much for joining us this evening. It's
thank
a pleasure
you.
To discuss your work. I was wondering if you could discuss your thought process and your meticulous composition of all of your frames, your still shots and otherwise. And I was wondering if your approach to those compositions will change at all when you enter television.
The process? Sure. How's the process? The photographer and I, we study a lot of paintings, a lot. From Lake Tahoe, we were obsessed with Rothko and Turner. We were obsessed with the colors, and you can see the film, Lake Tahoe, very still frames, but there are a lot of color. So we were obsessed with Rothko, and we were convinced that colors would reflect an emotion of the character. So that was our process. And if this obsessive framing would change if in the TV series, I don't know. No, I don't know. And we are working in the script of the TV series. I'm always with Maria Renee telling, let's go more in the intimacy. In the intimacy, let's go more for the intimacy. And Maria Renee says, okay, but let's be very careful because the TV series is all about going outside. Outside. It's not so much inside, it's not so much about intimacy. But I don't know. Let's see.
Are there any other filmmakers, whether they be like Mexican or on the global scale, who you feel influenced your style in filmmaking?
Contemporary filmmakers, or
just in your opinion, in your experience?
Oh, he means like current filmmakers or previous filmmakers or past filmmakers? I guess.
Either one. I don't know.
Either one. Vittorio De Sica. Yes, it was a Yes. Also, Yasuhiro Ozu, the Japanese filmmaker. But Vittorio De Sica, the Italian neorealism was really, really important for cinema all around the world. If you want to understand the modern cinema, you have to understand the Italian neorealism. I think that Bicycle Thieves is one of the most beautiful and most important films of the history of cinema. So it's an amazing film. Have you seen it?
I
have. You should. I'm
going to stand up, sorry. I'm going to quote you. I hope that's okay.
What?
So, in Filmmakers Magazine, you said, or you wrote, shooting with no risk is boring.
Yes.
And you spoke of the risk this evening. I was wondering if you could elaborate on that.
Yes. Yes. When we were shooting Dog Season, the teenagers were like a very chaotic teenagers. So I went one, it was like a mess, and they were doing a lot of kind. And I went with them and I said, okay, stop. We won't play games anymore. This will be a very serious film, stop. And Diego Cataño, that actually he was on Narcos, he has had 13 years. He said, but if we can play, it's not very boring. I'm like, no, it's okay. And that night I spent all the night and I'm like, okay, yes, it's about playing. And playing is about risks. So we take those risks. And it's strange because if you see the camera and the framing, it's very, and it's like, oh, there's no risk. But there are risks in terms of how the scene goes, how the characters will change. We can change the script with the actors. So there's that kind of risks. So yes, it's important. And if there's no risk, it's boring. And I think that in TV series, I don't know how much risk is there. I don't know how much. So sometimes it's a little, it's about plot and plot and plot and plot and plot. It's like a formula that's boring. And if you see great filmmakers, amazing filmmakers have done television, like Bergman. Fanny and Alexander was a TV series. And it's amazing because it's not about a plot, it's about characters. And it's a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful example of what television should be, or the Kalog from Kieslowski. It was not about plot. And I think that the plot is like a snack. And we should be more aware of the plot, because everything is plot, 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 plot. But the plot should turn into something bigger, because if it's just plot, it's boring. Well, I explained that. And about the there's no like a formula. I was in the film school, and they tried to teach me that there are formulas. That it's like a, and it's there's no formula. You should take risks. That's when art is done, when you take risks. Turn those risks.
Let me just confirm here that the wisdom that you're talking about with risks came from a 13-year-old.
Yes.
I just want to point that out. The wisdom of a 13-year-old. I have a 12-year-old, so I can see it's coming. So. Other questions? Yes.
So my question is, you portray Mexican society in a certain way, especially in Lake Tahoe, like there's like a rawness, the characters are really raw, or so I felt them, and they also have like this good nature that, I mean, me being Mexican, I have experienced this in the daily life, but how do you expect like the Mexican audience or your audience to react to these portrayals of Mexican society?
With that film, with Lake Tahoe,
yeah,
the response was terrible. Because it's talking about risks. The audience, the exhibition, the distribution should take risks, and they don't want to take risks. They want to put the same films in the cinemas, and that's terrible because the audience don't want to take risks. If you change a little bit the structure of a film to the audience, it's like, no, it's an art film, and I don't think that there are art films and commercial films. There are good films and bad films. They try to convince us that they're like art films. No, but an art, it's, there's no such thing like an art film. There are good and bad films. But if you want to go in a different way, if you want to put it in a different way, people will react like, and it's because there's not that diversity I was talking about. We need that diversity. If we have that diversity in the cinema, the people will be more open to risks. To take the risk as an audience, you should take risks also. If not, if you are with everybody like seeing the same film, and the same TV series.
So in Lake Tahoe, you have a lot of really interesting characters, but one in particular is David, the martial arts learning mechanic. How did you come up with that idea?
I don't know. I don't know how it worked. I just remember that I was seeing a lot of Bruce Lee films, and I was obsessed, and I really wanted to put a scene of a Bruce Lee film, but it was impossible because the rights were really, really expensive. But we found the music and the dialogues. It was not so expensive, so we bought them. So at that moment, there's no image, just sound, because we didn't have the money to pay for the image. So that kind of things, once again, it's about, okay, let's take the risk. And if it's a scene that it's like a 5 minutes with no image, just a black screen, and just hearing the dialogues, and we did a complete sequence just with sounds, and it was I really enjoyed that. And in that film in Lake Tahoe, we worked a lot in the sound design, a lot. We did the film. That film was edited in, I don't know, 1 month, very, very shortly. And the sound, it took us like 2 months or 5 months. We were exploring the sound of the sound. We were like enjoying that exploring. So.
So I know you said you really like having your films be more human, and you like using non-actors and actors. So I was curious if you ever considered being involved in a documentary or making one that could potentially reach a larger audience.
If I'm interested in doing a documentary, yes. Yes, actually we were working on 2 documentaries right now. And in the film school I did documentaries. I think it's one of the most beautiful ways of cinema. But at the same time, people are not very open to documentaries in cinemas. It's working in Netflix. Something is changing in documentary because people are more open to documentaries. And I think that's really good. But we need much more documentaries, much, and audiences to go to see those documentaries. Right now, it's like a, you said, someone to go to a cinema to pay a ticket to see a documentary. It's like, no. They prefer to go to the big, big show.
Let me say something quickly about film school, because this, and I thought about mentioning this earlier. So we showed you the clip from La Bienvenida. You can actually, Cine Pantera actually has the full La Bienvenida on, which is 10 minutes long, about online. So you can actually check that out if you want to see it. It has no subtitles, so you need to know Spanish for that, for the most part, but it actually, you can do it without it. But if you can understand Spanish and want your AIMCE Alternative Film School, there is a 2-hour masterclass online, which he actually like describes the whole process of making that particular film, and it's fascinating. So that's your alternative film school if you want to go and find this, because we don't have 2 hours here.
Yes. Yeah. So you just mentioned that, particularly in the film Lake Tahoe, you guys focus a lot on sound. So I just wanted to ask what you think of the lack of sound. So I know that earlier in this discussion you mentioned that silence adds a lot to your character. And in Lake Tahoe there was a really long shot where there was a dog and two characters, and there was just a very prolonged shot of just them eating cereal. So how do you feel that silence adds to your characters? How do you feel that it sort of makes the experience better, or just how does it add to your filmmaking?
Well, it's this. I'm a great filmmaker, Robert Bresson. He said that sound invented the silence in cinema. So. No, it's like when you are looking for silence, you will look, you will use sound, you will use a drop of water, you will use the sound of a tree, you will use the wind, you will use elements of sound to create silence. So, and silence is really, really important in the cinema. It's like music is created with silence. So cinema should have silence. It's like an equilibrium. And right now there are a lot of films that it's what they are most afraid about is to have silence. All the time it's like sound, and it's, once again, there's no, so silence is important on films.
Hi, so I saw your film Lake Tahoe a couple hours ago, and I would say I really liked it, and I'm planning on seeing the rest of your films.
Thank you.
In fact, I think I'll go to the screening tomorrow of Club Sandwich. But I did have a question about the framing of a Lake Tahoe, which is, I noticed you broke the rule of thirds a lot, which is that you centered a lot of your shots. And I was just curious if that was kind of an intentional choice, really in the vein of taking risks, or was that just something that kind of happened organically?
The framing?
Yes, so that you have a subject in the center of the shot versus on the sides of the frame.
It was intentional. There was a I have an image for the film. It was a small character in the middle of a big wall. That was, we were talking about Rothko and Turner. It was this character with big walls, and because the DP, we were convinced that helped to tell the story. The lighting, it's very, very from the top, and it's the most horrible light. No photographer
would like to work with that light because it's very, very hard on the characters. And the director of this of photography of this film decided to use this light to feel the character like oprimido, like oppressed. So because he's having a very difficult time and all the weather is going against him and the sun and everything. So it was really intentional. There was like a very, I think that you talk about this masterclass about La Bienvenida, and I want to talk briefly about the editing process and about the risk. The editing process is like the where the magic happens. It's where you create different things, where you found a lot of things in the film. So you must have time for exploring in the editing room. In La Bienvenida, the editor and I gave to some film students the rushes, the material, and the script. And we told them, okay, you edit the film. You should edit the film. And they did very, very different versions from the original. Very, very different. So the material changed a lot, and they create new stories, and it was really, really interesting. I think that the editing process, it's really, really interesting. Like the sound, like the image, they're like an important process of the filmmaking.
I'm noticing the same editor for all three of your feature films. So I was wondering, you talk about how the characters tend to inform the style of the film a lot. Do you feel that, I'm looking at her name right now, but do you feel like your editor also informs your style to a great degree as well? And is it intentional that you try and keep her around for every film that you've made?
If she influenced the films, the editing?
Yeah, like, do you think like her style is important to the films that you have made?
Yes, of course. It's like when you are making a film, it's like a work between a lot of people. I don't know how to shoot. I don't know how to shoot, to be the director of photography. I have a sense of editing. I love editing, but I'm not that professional. So you work with people that are professional on those things. And of course they teach you and they change a lot the things that you have planned, a lot. And that's what most that I enjoy about filmmaking. It's not you, is working with people. I spent in the editing room, I spent all the time, like behind the editor, and talking about life and that kind of things, but I stay there all day. And it's a process that I really enjoy. And I listen a lot. I like to listen a lot to the photographer, to the actors, to the editor. I really like to listen.
I just wanted to follow up on the question about sound with the music, because I know in Duck Season, there's very little non-diegetic music. I think it's only when they're eating the pot brownies. Mm-hmm. And then there's, I don't believe, any in Lake Tahoe. Is that a direction that you've continued to go in? And I just wanted to know about, my husband loved that there was no music in Lake Tahoe. He like hates like a really manipulative score, so he really appreciated that. So I just want to know if your thoughts on music in movies.
Well, that have a relation with your question. In Duck Season, there was this scene where they eat the marijuana brownies, and I was thinking what kind of music could work, and I was like thinking of the cliches like reggae and dub, that kind of thing. And I gave the editor, Mariana Rodriguez, a CD with the Beethoven concert piano, so she can have it. I said, it's great, please hear it and copy it to your computer. And when we were editing, she said, let's try this. And I was like, no. Beethoven and marijuana and that kind of thing, are you crazy? And she said, wait, let me try. And she did it, and it was one of the most beautiful moments in the film. And I really love it, and I really love it, and it was not my idea, it was her idea. And she was like, just go outside, lower there, and let me try this. And it was really, really amazing. And it was her proposal, completely. But also, the editor loves music, really loves music, and she respects music. So she thinks that it's really dangerous to use a lot of music in a film to create emotions. So you have to try to work with dialogues, with sounds, with no music. Bresson, he used to say that music was like a drug or like an alcohol, that it enhances everything. And it's the same. In some films, they use a lot of music to create some kind of emotion. And when you take out the music, there's nothing. So it's interesting, in the editing room, try not to use music. Try to create the sense of the dramatic sense of the scene without music. I think that music is sometimes for when you didn't done that emotion, you put music.
We have time for one or two questions more. Oh, and look, there's two hands up, so three. We'll do three quick ones. One, three. Two, three.
Okay. You want to go first? Okay. So you've won over 20 major awards for your work so far in your career, I believe. I was wondering if you could talk about which award was the most meaningful for your career. Just one.
The most beautiful award was when we screened Dog Season in the Guadalajara Film Festival. I was really, really, really scared and worried, and I saw the film, and I went with my producer, my partner, and I said, man, this is a really, really bad film. And he said, well, filmmaking is about making a lot of films, don't worry. So he also believed that it was a really bad film. And we were really scared. And I was hoping that the film were lost in the process from Mexico to Guadalajara. And then we showed the film in the press screening that used to be terrible. The press screenings are awful because all the press people are writing, and they go outside and they talk between them, and it was really amazing that they stayed there and they enjoyed the film, and they stayed till the end. And some of the festival told me, wow, that was good, because they stayed during the screening. And that was a moment that I enjoyed a lot, to see that the film worked with the audience. It's the most beautiful thing when you can sense that the film works with an audience. That's great. There's no trophy or thing that could be so important as the audience.
Cool. So on the note of films that work with the audience, Duck Season or Temporal Los Patos, it was a scene where, you know, they're going crazy. How do you tell, like, a non-actor, or I guess working with non-actors and real actors, how are you going to tell one of your actors, go slam your head against this wall, you know, 40 times? Like, how is it working with those kind of actors, and obviously that's a trademark of your movies, but how's it been over the past 3 or 4 films that we've all seen?
You should play with them. You should let them create. They are not actors, but they want to tell a story. They want to tell their story. And you have to find a way to tell their story and your story. And in that way you can play with them. That scene where they are going with them, we try different things and what should we do, and I don't know who proposed that. I don't know, because sometimes it's like, who was the idea? Who was the one who had the idea of that? I don't know, and I don't care. Just things happen, and you must be open. And non-actors, I like to work with actors and non-actors, because non-actors learns from the actors, learns in terms of to be in the set at time, to listen, and professional actors learns from non-actors, learns to take risks. So it's like a very beautiful combination. So I really enjoyed that. So, because if there's no, you are playing, but there's no like rules, like discipline, will be boring. So it's like you have to be like a game, but discipline. So yeah, and you should let them do the things. There are scenes that we completely changed because I read the script and they said it's horrible. These dialogues sounds horrible. And like, okay, what you should do, and they propose things. Yes,
last question over here, I think.
Thank you. I know you're a director that has worked in both black and white and color film, and oftentimes in color film, directors use the color of costuming to direct the viewer's eyes to a certain area on screen. What are some ways that you do that in black and white films when that's not really available?
Ah, that's great. With the geometry, you work in terms of mass. It's not like a, yes, it's like a geometry. You create a balance with the black and white. And I found it really, really beautiful and interesting to create that balance. It was the same that we did in the short film La Bienvenida. It was also black and white, and it's really beautiful to work in black and white. It's very sad that not so much films are done in black and white, because it's really interesting. It's totally different. Totally different, and it's now it seems like an old film, but it's, you know, it's really, really interesting.
Fernando, thank you so much for coming, and thank you. And tomorrow at the Inter-American Development Bank, the address is. Do we have the address somewhere? New York and 13th? Thank you. You have to RSVP. So you need to go to the internet and RSVP to make sure that, otherwise they're not going to let you in. So, I will put that in the Facebook group of the classes that I have. Need to do that. And do check out Club Sandwich. It's really, really beautiful. And you are beautiful as well. Thank you.
Thank you.